So good afternoon, everyone. I'd like to welcome you to Norwich University and the 2020 Military Writers Symposium. Our theme this year is weaponizing water, ancient tactics, current applications. I'd like to welcome you to our beloved state and our university here. And our regret for this symposium is that you're not physically able to be here and see the fall foliage of the amazing green mountains that's surrounding our institution here at this particular time. My name is Dr. Travis Morris. I'm the executive director for the Military Writers Symposium. I also have the honor of being the director for the Peace and War Center. I'd like all of you to know on the call that today's symposium and this panel in the theme is directly connected to the efforts of two centers, the Center for Global Resilience and Security, who will, the executive director will be introducing our honored guest speaker and panelist today, and the Patton Peace and War Center. So I'd like to just, for those of you that are joining for the very first time, and for those of you that have been some on the previous panels, I'd like to direct your attention to our website. We have an introduction from President Anarumo that just provides some context and background of the symposium and just gets you up to speed of where we've been for the past 25 years and the relevance and importance of today's panel. We are thrilled today to be joined by the Honorable Sherri Goodman. We have worked with her over several initiatives. We're always thrilled to have her back, and we'll have a more detailed introduction here in a few seconds. But Sherri, so glad that you could be with us once again here at Norwich. So for those of you that have been with us, we've had an engaging lineup for you. We've had some excellent presentations. There have been some excellent questions and some good engagements from leadership to the environment and why this topic is critically important, not just for those who are currently in the field or those who are in positions of leadership, but also those who will become leaders into different sectors of the security environment and government. This year is our inaugural year of doing this virtually. For the past 25 years, we've hosted leading thinkers, authors, and scholars here at Norwich, but now we're coming to you across the globe in your homes or your offices. And taking advantage of that, we've had several new additions, and one of those is the connection to Norwich Pro. You can get a micro certificate in the Arctic Cold War, and this year it's free. And if you're interested in signing up for Norwich Pro, again, go to our website. You can see on the very landing page that there's a segment on Norwich Pro. If you're interested in continuing the conversation and going deeper in this topic of weaponizing water and environmental security, you have an option of doing that with the world-renowned scholar as well as other engaged professionals that will be part of Norwich Pro. If you're not a Military Writers Symposium associate, just like to ask that you would consider being one. There are no fees, just the expectation that you would help partner with us to help us to grow our beloved symposium into even higher horizons. The newsletter and a message from the chairman and more information, again, is available on our webpage as well as his contact information. And over the course of today's session, should you have any questions, if you look at your GoToMeeting control panel, there's a section there that says questions. Feel free to type in a question at any time throughout our presentation. So it's an honor for me to introduce one of my colleagues here at Norwich University, Dr. Tara Kilcarney, who is also the director for our Center for Global Resilience and Security. And she will introduce our honored guest speaker. So Dr. Kilcarney, please.
Thank you, Dr. Morris. And it's really my honor to introduce the Honorable Sherri Goodman. Sherri Goodman is Secretary General of the International Military Council on Climate and Security, Senior Strategist and Advisory Board Member at the Center for Climate and Security, and Senior Fellow at the Woodrow Wilson International Center's Polar Institute and Environmental Change and Security Program. Sherri served as the President and CEO of the Consortium for Ocean Leadership. Earlier, she served as Senior Vice President and General Counsel of CNA, that's the Center for Naval Analyses, where she was also the founder and Executive Director of the CNA Military Advisory Board. whose landmark reports include several on climate change and national security, energy and national security, and the role of water stress in instability and conflict, among others. The film, The Age of Consequences, in which Sherri is featured, is based on the work of the CNA Military Advisory Board. Sherri served as the first Deputy Undersecretary of Defense for Environmental Security from 1993 to 2001. As the Chief Environmental Safety and Occupational Health Officer for the Department of Defense, she established the first environmental safety and health performance metrics for the department and led its energy, environmental, and natural resource conservation programs. She has practiced law as both a litigator and environmental attorney and serves on the boards of multiple organizations. Sherri has written a book, The Neutron Bomb Controversy, a case study in alliance politics, and authored dozens of reports and articles on a broad range of nuclear, energy, and environmental security issues. She has testified before numerous committees of the US Congress and appears frequently in national, international, and online media. She has been an adjunct instructor in international affairs and security at the Kennedy School of Government and an adjunct research fellow at the Kennedy School's Center for Science and International Affairs. Sherri has received numerous honors and awards, including an honorary doctorate from Amherst College in 2018, the Department of Defense Distinguished Service Award in 1998 and 2001, the Gold Medal Award from the National Defense Industrial Organization in 1996, and the Environmental Protection Agency's Climate Change Award in 2000. A summa cum laude graduate of Amherst College, she earned a law degree from Harvard Law School and a master's in public policy degree from Harvard Kennedy School of Government. Please join me in welcoming the Honorable Sherri Goodman.
Well, thank you, Tara and Travis, so much for that lovely introduction. My mother should have been here to hear that. She would have gushed. But often what we say, in the Pentagon is the more titles you have, the less important your job is. So I just want to throw that out there, too. Anyway, it's a pleasure to be with you all today from wherever you're tuning in. I'm in Washington, D.C., although I wish I were in New England because I love fall in New England. And I was really looking forward to being at Norwich this time of year. So let's get started. I know that those of you who are participating already have considered some of these subjects on water security and water. And I want to get into this in the context of water and climate security in the age of global disruption. So let's go. Thank you, Nicole, for being my expert slide flipper here. Let's go to the next slide. I want to put this in some historical context for you. So I think about the convergence of national security and climate security, which to me, we're going to sort of do some deeper dives on water as we get into this. But it's all kind of mixed in here. And of those of you who are cold warriors like myself, you remember the nuclear age and the founding of NATO and the Warsaw Pact and Star Wars and the element, and then the wall comes down, the Berlin Wall, and we move into the post-Cold War era. And at the same time, what you see is sort of the growing focus on environmental issues, at least I'll put this a little more in the US with a bit of an international context. You know, growth of environmental laws, which is true in many countries around the world, but also the international agreements, with the Montreal Protocol, the formation of the International Panel on Climate Change, the Rio Conference in 1992. And what I characterize as sort of the convergence of national and climate security, where today climate and water security really are an central elements of our national security. Next slide. And we really addressed this first, including water, climate, and security, back in the U.S. at least, despite knowing for many years since the formation of the IPCC and early research by scientists. But the connections between climate change and national security really emerged in the mid 2000s with the release in 2007 of the CNA Military Advisory Board report on national security and the threat of climate change. This was really the first report, and it was chaired by your distinguished alum, General Gordon Sullivan, who chaired for me the very first CNA Military Advisory Board report, a group of a dozen generals and admirals, retired 3 and 4 stars, representing all of our combatant commands, serving all around the world, and all of our services, number of service chiefs, and COCOM commanders, General Zinni, Admiral Preer, General Sullivan, and a number of others. And we spent a year looking at climate science and learning from our leading climate scientists, also meeting with intelligence and national security experts. And in 2007, we characterized climate change as a threat multiplier for instability in some of the most volatile regions of the world. Now you'd say now, like, duh, come on, we know that already. Yeah, okay, but we didn't know that 13 years ago. And we also predicted that it was going to add to tensions around the world and even in stable regions like our own. And that we also, climate change, national security, energy, and I put in there water, are related set of challenges. So this board has released about a dozen reports over the last dozen years, looking at various aspects of national security, energy, and climate change. And we'll get into one specifically on water. Next slide, please. Okay, now Travis, Tara and I talked about in advance what we're gonna do on this slide, which actually is tease up a trailer for the film, Age of Consequences, which Tara mentioned, which is about the threat multiplier aspect of climate change. And I think they were going to put it, if it goes out there now, well, we hope you'll watch it afterwards. But I know if any of you are the age of my kids who are in college, you'd probably be watching it now. Okay, anyway, it's the trailer for the film. And then you could, I think if you want to see the whole film, it's probably available on Netflix now. Next slide. Okay, so what are the threat multipliers of climate change? Probably many of you know them, but just to remind you, heat, the global temperatures have risen dramatically around the world, nowhere more so than the Arctic. We now have extended drought in many parts of the world that is changing livelihoods, changing agriculture. We have almost a year-round fire season now, you know, the devastation in California, Oregon, Washington, even across Siberia seems to know no limits almost. We have a dramatic sea level rise in many coastal regions around the world, intense flooding in many areas, and then extreme weather, hurricanes, cyclones, storms, and there are more of them, but I just picked out those few to give you a sense of what are those threat multipliers. Next slide. So, of course, droughts, you know, let's take a little bit deeper dive in there. You know, we now have extended droughts occurring across Africa, the Middle East, parts of Asia, Latin America, even the Southwest, so that this is really changing the way we think about water. It is water too much or too little is the front line. Next slide, please. And sea level rise. You know, events that used to occur once per century now projected to occur once per year by 2050. So we have places that have regular sunny day flooding now, like some of our key military installations and communities in Norfolk, Virginia, that have sunny day flooding. And there's water in the streets so that people sometimes can't get to work. And that's sort of the least of it. We have whole villages, towns, cities that could be uninhabitable in the next quarter century, not to mention specific island nations that may actually lose their whole, that may lose their ability to inhabit people. Next slide, please. And then the storms. The storms are occurring ever more intensely. Now we have another storm moving, making its way through the Gulf. We've seen more storms this year than ever before, and their average intensity has increased. So their wind speed, there was the devastation in the Bahamas from Hurricane Dorian, you see here, equally devastating, comparably devastating storms from other related hurricanes occurring across the Gulf and the East Coast of the US, but also across much of Asia, even storms of devastating historical proportions in Mozambique and parts of Africa in the last few years. Next slide. Okay. Okay, well, we wouldn't be online today, you know, if it weren't the case that we had this COVID crisis now, which is none of us have ever experienced in our lifetime. It may be connected to, you know, increased mishandling of wildlife and biodiversity challenges. So it also is connected to our natural world in a way. And this is another sort of set of cascading risks, one that hopefully we'll be able to get a better handle on in the next few years, but we'll still have the climate and water insecurities with us. Next slide. Okay. And just to sort of put it in context, you know, disaster risks around the world are rising because vulnerable populations increasingly exposed to hazards. So, you know, this is how we measure it, sort of the type of hazard, the type of exposure. And as you can see from this picture, you know, there are many places around the world where their people live in very exposed ways and their vulnerability is high, leading to direct mortality, indirect losses, and also spillover times. Now we face, you know, the greatest wave of global migration that we've experienced since World War II as a sort of second order effect from these increasing disaster risks. Next slide. And we also have increasing disaster cost. This just shows you in the US some of the billion-dollar weather and climate disaster mapping that's been done over the last century. And you can see where these different threat multipliers, droughts and heat waves, flooding, wildfires, severe local storms, and the cost, we're paying for it now. You know, we say sometimes pay now or pay later. Well, we're paying now in disaster cost because we haven't yet fully invested in abating the climate changes. Next slide. Okay, so, you know, all of these different elements are affected by this. This sort of leads us into the next section. What happens with these threat multipliers? Increase in interstate conflict, population displacement and migration, resource conflicts, destabilized economic sectors. We have a lot of critical security and infrastructure risk, expansion of terrorist groups who prey on vulnerable populations, and of course, failing agriculture. Next slide. Okay, so now we're going to take a little bit deeper dive into some work that we did with the CNA Military Advisory Board in 2017 on water stress and instability, where we look, next slide, please, at the spectrum of conflict, water and the spectrum of conflict. And I think this is particularly useful, you know, for those of you who are military writers and who want to look at the role of water stress, to sort of have in mind what we call this, you know, some people say peace or war. Well, you know, those of you who are in this field know it's not, you know, it's not one or the other. There is a spectrum of coming from, you know, civil unrest and instability to localized violence, terrorism, insurgencies, and then ultimately, you know, state on state conflict. And water has a role in each of those. And I urge you, if any of you are really, you know, scholars in this field, take a look at that report because there are sort of chapters across each of these elements and case studies on each of them. Let's go to the next slide, please. So here's one case study. Some of you who study this area may know this well, that the historic drought that occurred beginning in 2006 in Syria, first led a farmers and herders who had lived peaceably in the countryside to move towards the urban areas, towards the cities, as their fields dried up and they could no longer tend to their herds. And that led to civil unrest and then localized violence as protests and unrest in the urban areas. Then violent extremist organizations targeted key water infrastructure as a strategic security asset. And then ultimately major powers became involved, and it became, you know, one of the greatest conflicts and loss of life, migration in deadliest conflict in the world today, and water stress was a key element of it. Let's go to that next slide, Nicole. That's great, because this just puts it in a sort of timeline, and you can see the historic droughts actually going back even. The one that the conflict is associated with started in 2005, but there were droughts before then. And so the water stress, water scarcity were contributing elements to the uprising in Syria. And you can see there were internally displaced populations, as well as Iraqi refugees. Next slide, please. Now, one of my friends, a scholar, if you're really into this, I urge you to read the work of Marcus King. And this is from some work, he's at GW, and he's done some very cogent analysis on the ways in which water is becoming a weapon of war, weaponizing water in the six particular ways. And he's looked at it specifically for Iraq and Syria. I think he's also recently done some work in Northern Africa, Horn of Africa. But we see particularly, we've seen water withheld or contaminated to create fear among non-combatants and to harness the local vulnerable local populations. You've seen it used tactically to destroy or deny access to military targets in the battle space. Or you've seen it in the case, for example, of the Mosul Dam targeting water to destroy important areas, infrastructure, and affect whole broad populations and a variety of other elements. And I think this characterization is really useful analytically because, it goes back to biblical times in the ways that water has been weaponized, but we've seen it now done in a whole new set of ways in this modern era. Next slide, please. Okay, sort of continuing take a kind of a little tour around the world on water and climate hotspots. One that is, particularly challenging and of strategic interest is Pakistan, which is at a global crossroads, an unstable nuclear armed country. And it's losing its glaciers quite quickly, and that leads to runoff, and then there's flooding. They also face sea level rise in their coastal areas, changes in monsoon. They've had historic flooding with major loss of life. They're already water scarce, and electricity and energy is very unreliable across the country too. So this is a very challenging country from a climate and water security standpoint. Next slide. Another one that's often mentioned sort of in the climate category is Bangladesh, being one of the world's most vulnerable climate stressed countries, with very dense population living at very low levels, clustered in along the coastal areas. Has seen many refugees from Myanmar in recent years, rising sea levels, saline intrusion, inadequate economic opportunities, and India has already built a fence to keep Bangladeshis out from crossing over into India, its primary neighbor. So people talk about the potential for up to 20 million or more climate refugees in future years from Bangladesh. Next slide, please. Okay. Across Africa, particularly the Sahel, Northern Africa, another extremely water-stressed region. These four countries highlighted on this slide, it's no coincidence that this is also where you know, security forces have been most heavily deployed over recent years as water stress, either through drought, desertification, sometimes deforestation and inadequate water supply, or in the case of Niger, overgrazing and soil erosion as well, have led to opportunities for extremists from Boko Haram to Al-Qaeda and others, localized groups, to take advantage of those vulnerable populations. The Lake Chad region, one very much studied by those interested in climate security, how that important water basin, which sits at the juncture of four major countries in that part of Africa, which has shrunk very much, but now there have been over the last decade efforts to rehabilitate it and restore the livelihoods with local community engagement and participation of local citizens can be brought back. Next slide, please. Okay. This is an interesting, this graph tells an interesting story about what's happening in China, I mean, excuse me, in the Pacific Islands today, with the increasing presence of China, for example. That's why that A2AD Outer Island Chain Line is there, drawn extending the nine dash line, but also the COFA nations of Palau, former states of Micronesia and Republic of Marshall Islands, which are US territories, increasingly vulnerable to sea level rise, loss of fresh water, saline intrusion, extreme weather events. And this also shows how these risks get compounded because not only are they facing climate risk, they face economic risks. China now offering, positioning itself as the provider of first resort for what we call humanitarian assistance and disaster relief. Some of these nations, like Kiribati in Palau, are already looking to buy property or have bought property in Fiji because they expect they'll have to move substantial portions of their population in coming decades. And also at the same time have switched their diplomatic affiliation from Taiwan to Beijing. So this is increasingly complex region of the world where tensions are mounting as China gains ever greater influence in an area where that the US, I think historically, probably assumed was its own backyard, but we would be mistaken to continue to think that way with these risks, food, water, and climate continuing to mount. Next slide, please. Okay. Well, from the Pacific Islands, we're going to move to the Arctic, a region that whose opening deeply concerns me. What you could say is that we have a whole new ocean, the Arctic, that's opened in our life, at least in my lifetime. During the Cold War, I was working on programs like Arctic Military Environmental Cooperation, where we were helping the Russian military remove safely liquid waste streams from decommissioned Russian submarines that had sunk in Murmansk along there in Western Russia. Now we have an Arctic increasingly open for commerce. This year marked the 14th year of the 14th lowest sea ice measured in mid-September just a few weeks ago. So sea ice is retreating, permafrost is thawing, and temperatures are rising at rates faster than is seen on the rest of the planet. Russia, which has a long Arctic coastline, and you can see the Northern Sea Route on this map, is looking to monetize that Northern Sea Route as a toll road for transit from ports in Asia to ports in Europe, could cut potentially 3 weeks off shipping times. China has declared itself a near Arctic stakeholder and has ambitions to conduct a Polar Silk Road, is already engaged very heavily in investments with Russia. So they've stepped up their strategic cooperation. There's now a Siberian pipeline bringing Russian gas into China. China's investing in the Yamal LNG plant. So there's increasing energy and other cooperation between those two adversaries. And that's troubling for the U.S. In numerous ways. Okay, next slide, please. What keeps me up at night? Last year, we did a scenario exercise with the National Academy of Sciences in Sandia National Laboratories, looking at the possibility of a Russian, an increasingly nuclearized Russia in the Arctic. And they already have close to 40 icebreakers, more than a dozen of them nuclear powered. And they've built a nuclear powered floating energy plant, which just made its first maiden voyage. And they're increasingly going to be plying the Arctic in these nuclear vessels. And we looked at a scenario where a Russian nuclear icebreaker collides with its Chinese escorted LNG vessel in the Bering Strait in 2050, as you see in these plots on the map, projected sea ice decline and the 21st century transarctic shipping routes. And at its closest point, the US and the US, Alaska and Russia are only 30 miles apart in the Bering Strait. So these are increasingly challenging future scenarios that's important to consider in a in coming years. Next slide, please. Okay. Now, you know, it's also as we look south, we also see increasingly challenges in the Caribbean and Latin America, where you've got increasing droughts and hurricanes across the Caribbean. You've seen that's become challenging across many of the small island nations that have depended heavily on tourism. Now they've lost that in COVID. They already had weak governance, already subject to narco trafficking and increasing illegal fishing, migration and immigration. So it's another set of cascading risks across that region. Next slide, please. Okay. All right, let's move on. I want to just take a few more minutes and talk about how we get to sort of from this from these unprecedented risks to unprecedented foresight. Next slide, please. I want to talk a little bit about the impacts on the U.S. military of these climate threat multipliers. As we see increasingly our troops subject to heat stress, we've already lost $1 billion to heat in the decade 2008 to 2018, and that's likely to continue to mount if we continue to deploy our forces in parts of the world that may be uninhabitable, may be inhospitable for humans outside of air conditioning in coming decades. And we have an increasing number of Black Flag days, even in our own, as we do our own training in the U.S., where it's consistently over 90 degrees and puts soldier, sailor, airmen, and Marines at risk should they be outside too long. Next slide, please. So we've got risk to people. We've got risk to bases. We have an increasing number of military bases around the country and around the world that are subject to flooding, extreme temperatures, wind, drought, fire. Particularly in our coastal areas along the Atlantic, some of our most critical military bases have already faced substantial damage. Next slide, please. I think this one shows it. Okay, well, next. So here's Offutt Air Force Base in Nebraska, which was significantly damaged by flooding in 2019 because we had, not properly anticipated these historic events. And here you can see the increased changes in heavy precipitation across the U.S. Next slide, please. But we do also have some foresight. You know, in this era of AI and automation and quantum computing and improved predictive capabilities, there are, it's not all bad news. Okay, next slide, please. So, in a report we did at the Center for Climate Security earlier this year on a climate security plan for America, how can we really get our handle on this? And we looked at it in really four buckets, which is, you know, we need to climate proof our infrastructure. As I just showed you off it, that's probably Tyndall Air Force Base down there, which suffered major damage in Hurricane Michael. And then Hurricane Florence came through Camp Lejeune, North Carolina, and devastated that. Secondly, we need to sustain our military training in rangelands, and there's more we can do sort of on natural infrastructure and ecosystem management there. We need new defense investments to be climate resilient in our weapon systems. And then finally, we need our combatant commands to include climate risks in their planning process. Next slide, please. Okay, and sort of getting to the tech side of this, there's an increasing range of energy or climate tech technologies that are being explored in the Department of Defense and related laboratories today, which present opportunities. I'd say most of these are in their early stages, although we've increased, you know, we have a lot of solar at military housing around the country. On the battlefield, you know, we've put some solar in. But we have more and more opportunities to reduce our risks by better being able to predict them. Next slide, please. So last year we formed the first International Military Council on Climate and Security. My partner in this is the former Dutch Chief of Defense, General Tom Mittendorp. We have over 50 military leaders. I think we're up to over 30 countries now. And we issued the first World Climate Security Report earlier this year at the Munich Security Conference. Next slide, please. Okay, and we looked in this report at these climate impacts, some of those we've gone through in this, you know, we've gone through in this presentation, but I urge you, particularly those of you affiliated with international military organizations, we'd be happy to learn. I'd be happy to hear from you and connect you with the IMCCS and see if we can find a way to bring you on board. Okay, next slide, please. General Sullivan, former Army Chief of Staff and great alum of Norwich University, and I, we wrote this piece on climate change threatens the backbone of America's global power. So we do have time to mobilize. We don't have to wait for another Pearl Harbor or 9/11, but we've got to do it now. We don't have time to waste. Next slide, please. And regaining our global leadership, we need to look even more broadly as we are today, not just climate, but water and also natural security, which includes ocean health. I didn't give you that briefing today, but also biodiversity. And with my co-author here for this piece, we kind of looked at those three buckets, climate change, ocean health, and biodiversity as being the components of a natural security strategy. We have to look at ourselves in a systems approach, the whole natural system of which we are a part here on the planet. Next slide. And finally, you know, we can see these, you know, we increasingly see climate change threatening our national security, but we can do something about it if we act now. Next slide. And I will finish with this one with a little bit of information about how to contact me. And now's the time to act. But first, now's the time for me to answer your questions. Thank you very much for joining me today.
You've given us definitely a lot to think about and consider from many different countries, many different problems. And also you've highlighted several individuals and entities that are the tip of the spear that are engaging this. And so the first question comes from an individual that's so aware of some of your reports and some of your high level profile engagements with governments. And so their question is, recognizing the fact that you've been involved in the production of several well done and comprehensive documents of challenges and need, in what ways have these reports changed the ways in which the US government addresses water security as part of foreign policy?
Okay, great question. And I didn't throw in the slide here where I document how those reports have actually been translated into legislation. But the very first CNA Military Advisory Board report on national security and the threat of climate change was actually the recommendations from that report were introduced on the Defense Authorization Bill right after the report was released in 2007 by then Senators John Warner and Hillary Clinton, bipartisan amendments on the defense bill enacted into law, signed by the president, which was President Bush at the time, spring of 2008, to require that the national security strategy, the national defense strategy, the national military strategy, the quadrennial defense review, these are all U.S. Department of Defense documents. Well, the president issues a national security strategy. The others are from the Department of Defense. And then the intelligence community does an intelligence assessment, include the national security implications of climate and water security. So that's been going on since 2008. Each year, each couple of years when the guidance for that QDR document or the national security strategy is drafted, it's usually been expanded to include more elements like energy, water, natural systems, ecosystems. You know, under this administration, I'd say they've really cut that back and limited it, although I'd say that both Secretary of Defense, former Secretary of Defense Mattis and former DNI Director Coates were very, very forthright in their public statements about the need to address water and climate insecurities as part of their mission, both military and intelligence. And then there have been bipartisan provisions on the defense bills, the intelligence bills, and in the Foreign Relations Committee authorizations directing further evaluation of, let's say, water availability across across military bases, water insecurities as it affects our global fragility. There's a Global Fragility Act. There's a very active group right now called in the Department of Defense called Resource Competition, Environmental Security, and Stability, which earned the acronym RECESS. And this is a group, an interagency group started within DOD and OSD in the Stability Office there to integrate water and environmental security evaluations into other strategic actions like this Global Fragility Act. There was also a separate from that, there was a few years ago, under this administration, they released a global water strategy, which was directed by law. And the elements of it are really not bad. Now, it hasn't been well resourced, so the US has not been very active in what one might call sort of hydro diplomacy efforts, the most important of which is right now would be, let's say, the Grand Renaissance Dam. That Ethiopia is building that's going to affect downstream riparian countries, Egypt and Sudan most dramatically. And U.S. historically had been involved as negotiating and creating some diplomatic off-ramps for that, but has been, I think, not very engaged in the recent years.
Excellent. Thank you, Sherri. So I'm going to combine two questions here. And both of these questions are interested in the Paris Agreement and U.S. withdrawal. So I'll read a statement and then follow up with the question. The Department of Defense understands that climate change is a certain risk. Recognizing that threat multipliers related to climate change are linked to national and global insecurity, why is it reasonable or not for the U.S. government to pull out of the Paris Climate Accords, and how does it affect our international climate partnerships?
Well, it's very unreasonable that we're on the verge of pulling out, that we've announced under this administration we would pull out, because it's cost us our global leadership and global standing. I mean, here we have, you know, China just in the UN a couple of weeks ago declared that it was going to be net zero in its emissions by 2060, and trying to claim the mantle of climate leadership while it's still building coal-fired power plants and is the largest global emitter. I mean, the U.S. should be on this case. It's in our strategic interest to do so. both for the planet itself through reducing our own emissions and leading the clean energy transition, where we should have a competitive advantage in our technology, in our innovation, and because this is going to be a growth area of the economy, but also because our allies and our partners are waiting. They're waiting for the U.S. They are feeling our absence, and others come in to fill that vacuum when we've left the stage.
Excellent. Thank you very much. So we're going to take a different direction here, and it's going to incorporate some of the items you discussed on your presentation, particularly the Arctic and then China. So it's a rather direct question, but what is your position on China now being a member of the Arctic Group of Nations vis-a-vis water policy there?
Well, I guess I'm going to break that down a little bit. China is with respect to the Arctic, China is not an Arctic nation. It has no Arctic coastline. It's not, it's an observer to the, at the Arctic Council, which is the governance organization among the Arctic nations, although there's no mandate to address security in the Arctic Council, but they do address other elements from environment to shipping to search and rescue and research and development. And China has been an observer. I mean, there's many non-Arctic countries are observers at the Arctic Council. That in itself is not a problem. With respect to water and China, you know, China controls really the headwaters of many of the major rivers of Asia. So it's in a position with its dam building, and sometimes I have a slide in my deck that shows that in the map of those rivers, to deny or limit access to water to its downstream riparian neighbors, such as India, Bangladesh, Vietnam, and along those great rivers of Asia, the Mekong, the Brahmaputra, the Ganges, and others. And so this is increasingly problematic. Now, parts of China are very water scarce in the north. Other parts in the south and along the coastal areas are very much at risk for sea level rise and flooding. So like the U.S., you know, it's a very big country, diverse geography, different climate impacts internally. Water pollution and air pollution have been among the major challenges the country has faced, you know, in recent decades, air pollution being the one sort of most costly to society and the Chinese society, and one around which they've really just recently in the last decade or more kind of mobilized to address so that they don't face increasing internal unrest. Water insecurity is another one where they've built dams and often ignored the needs of local populations, moved whole populations just in order to gain industrial capability. So this is an area that, there are some major transboundary water agreements around the world, and the U.S. had been quite active in participating in some of those or leading them, a Mekong River Initiative and others. Some of that work continues to go forward without us, without the U.S. being very active in it right now. But those efforts, like arms control, you would say, they need care and feeding even when there are tensions. And sometimes they need more care and feeding when there are tensions among nations, because that's when the risk of miscalculation or accident increases.
Thank you, Sherri. So we have two questions from students, and I'll start with one that takes us down a really different pathway. So the questioner is asking, do you think that a greater presence of environmental security in popular media is an effective way in generating awareness and driving discussion? And then the following statement says that he recalls, or she recalls, in Call of Duty, which was one of the most popular first person shooting game, that there's a war over the Nile River as an access for its a plot. So again, do you think the greater presence of environmental security in popular media is generating additional awareness? And they use an example of an extremely popular first person game.
Oh, we've COD, yes, yeah. When I want to find out where my kids are when they were a little younger, I was always like, oh, they're downstairs playing COD. Okay, well, yes, Call of Duty, I think absolutely in gaming, in popular media, I think that's happened already. That's why I'd say, the younger generation gets it. It's not political. It just is. This is happening. And increasingly, these are the issues are not whether the climate is changing or whether humans involve it, but what should the energy transition look like? How should we achieve deep decarbonization? What should be those net zero targets? And what technology should we invest in to get us there? And that's where the right kind of policy level discussion should be had, not over whether it's happening. And then, so really what can we do about it in terms of water? How do you have sustainable and climate smart agriculture? How do you reduce waste? We lose so much water to waste through agriculture and through others. And then how do you improve in certain parts of the world? Really have to work on improving water quality. Water quality is as much a problem as water quantity. Still so many parts of the developing world have inadequate potable or clean water, drinking water, and inadequate wastewater and sewage treatment. And that's really the first line of, that's a first line of health, that we need to address.
Thank you very much, Sherri. So this next question definitely comes from one of our students, and they write, as a future lieutenant in the Army, hoping to go infantry, how do you see environmental security and the weaponization of water impacting future deployments?
Ah, great question, Lieutenant. Okay, well, I think the two interesting questions to ask here is how will growing global water scarcity and insecurity affect where you might be deployed? Okay, and then the second part of the question is, how will that affect your water access when you get there? Okay, on the first part, the strategic question, personally, I think that after over a decade of involvement in land wars in water scarce regions in the Middle East, I just don't see the U.S. going back there anytime real soon in a big way. Not that we won't have units, but I don't think we're going to be deploying at the same rate. So, but I do think that water and climate insecurities are aggravating tensions. I mean, where are areas that might flare up soon? Something could happen in the South China Sea. Something could happen in Iran, in the Middle East, when the U.S. comes back after the navel gazing it's been in from the last 4 years and gets back on the global stage, I think we're going to have to figure out how to reset our presence. Now, some of this may be as technology advances with, automation and robotics. Maybe you won't have to deploy yourself so much, but you might be operating something that is deployed. And maybe you're going to operate it, from a base remotely somewhere. Okay, so when you deploy, we learned the hard way in Afghanistan and Iraq that deploying to remote forward operating bases stressed the logistics tail and put soldiers who were driving trucks at risk, because most of those logistics vehicles were transporting fuel and water, often plastic bottles, which created waste. So, the military got on the case, and in the last decade and a half has innovated in more energy efficient ways to provide fuel and water to the front. So I think that will be better. The French in particular, for example, they're a military that is long in their deployments in Africa, try to find local sources of water. The U.S. has not traditionally been as big on that. We've been more about figuring out how to bring our own water or decontaminate water sources as opposed to digging wells. So, you know, it could be a mix in the future. I could see different ways in which you'll be looking at how to provision water for you or for your troops. My son, when he spent the summer at the Army's Engineering Research Lab, was part of a team working on the Water Dog water decontamination unit for deployed soldiers. And so those are kind of among the technologies that are coming forward for the future.
Hey, thank you, Sherri. So we have about 4 minutes left, and just I'm going to condense a question here. Would you be able to speak about any leading military climate adaptation measures that you've seen? Just maybe one or two.
You know, the military can be at the front lines of building back better. When we're building back now Tyndall Air Force Base, you know, we're going to make that base much more resilient and enable the hangars there to better withstand higher wind temperatures. I think that we're now going to learn, in some ways, a hard way from destruction that's been caused at Tyndall, Lejeune, Offutt, and elsewhere. We'll probably work a little faster, I hope we will, to integrate what I call climate tech predictive capabilities. In other words, to understand where, how to predict the kinds of climate conditions under which we have to operate. I showed you why in one of my earlier slides, I didn't call it out, but there was this red thing called the sail drone on the climate tech, and that collects ocean data, and that's been very helpful, for example, for our forces when we go up to the Arctic now. And we've got to gather data, and much more efficient, for example, than sending out big ships. You could put out lots of sail drones, collect various ocean data, and that's helping us better have ocean data both for science and for the operating forces.
Sherri, thank you very much for just an engaging presentation, and as well as fielding our questions from all different perspectives. In fact, your slide deck has given us a year worth of material just to discuss, and even more so. So thank you very much for taking some extremely complex topics and very difficult subjects and condensing that down into a very manageable format. And so on behalf of the Military Writers Symposium in Norwich University, thank you so much, Sherri, for giving us an excellent presentation and engagement. So thank you.
Thank you, Travis. It's been a pleasure to you and Tara. I only wish I were there with you all in person.
We do as well. And so for everyone else that's joining this meeting, Sherri is going to also be part of a panel tomorrow that will be released at noon. So if you want to see her as well as our previous panelists, just come back to the Military Writers Symposium website at noon tomorrow. You'll see an engaging session where the authors will interact together and in a very informative format. So we're going to take an hour break. You'll use the same link to re-engage once again at 4 o'clock. And at that session, it's going to be extremely informative and how to publish. And this is the part of the Military Writer Symposium in which we provide just the mechanical aspect of being a military writer. And for those of you that have an idea, have been working on a project, Randy's going to walk us through some aspects and getting that published. So Sherri, thank you once again. Enjoy the rest of your day, and we wish you the best in all your endeavors as you continue just to be at the tip of the spear of an incredibly important domain. All the best to you, Sherri. Thank you so much.
Okay, thanks, Travis. Bye, all.
Bye-bye.